So as you can see, in Sweden, you can go from the beach to the ice hotel right away. But to talk about the great things that Sweden has done, we will actually have three Swedes on the stage. We will have Christina, who comes from the Ministry of, I have to look at this, Enterprise and Innovation, and here's the whole e-government work there. She will be joined by Magnus, where are you? All right, Magnus, who works in, as a senior advisor in the same unit. And in a true sort of public-private partnership mode, there's also Klaus, who's the CEO of Mobilearn, who will also, you know, be up here. But besides the fun facts about countries, I actually teased each and one speaker to have a fun fact about their relationship to digital. So, you know, you'll learn a bit more on the speakers. For example, Christina here, well, she confessed that although she is on most social media platforms, so you can really look her up and link up with her there, she doesn't really go there, so don't bother. So, rather, you know, if you want to get in touch with her, text her. That's her thing, all right? But I think Magnus sort of follows the same sort of path about, and he said, you know, he's all about mixing the paper and the digital world and finding the right balance. So for example, he's confessed that he now has switched back to paper almanac as a recent thing. So that might be the nouveau hipster, I guess. And Klaus, well, for Klaus, I can say that he's actually the curious character. He's been in the IT industry for 24 years, but if you look at him, he only looks like 25. So go figure that out. But Sweden, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, it's an honor to be here today. And it's a great opportunity to exchange experience between the Nordic countries and to learn from each other. Thank you, Tavi and Estonia, for arranging this conference this year as well. We enjoyed it last year, and we are enjoying it today as well. We are looking forward to our interesting colleague giving speeches later on. Sweden is the first country out today, and it is my pleasure to introduce both Magnus and Klaus later on. They will give you some good examples of innovative digital solutions in the public sector. But first, I want to share with you where Sweden stands today. We are in the middle of a re-engineering process in Sweden. We are moving now from e-government to a digital government and bringing the citizens to the heart of the government. Our strategy was decided by the former government in 2012. But has been adopted by our new government as well. Our goals are a public sector characterized by simplicity, openness, and effectiveness. And the new government is now transforming the strategy into an action. The new government is now transforming the strategy into action and has presented a four-year program for a digital renewal of the Swedish public sector. The program includes financing, organization, and governance. For example, we have a program financing cross-agency projects. We have a new division set up for digital public sector at the Ministry of Innovation and Enterprise, which I'm happy to be head of. And we also are setting up a strategic council to the minister. The program will be focusing on implementing a national digital infrastructure and to drive smart digital innovations in different sectors. For example, in the building sector, entrepreneurs, health sectors. But we are also creating a platform for open innovation where businesses, agencies, and academics can meet. Together with some of our government agencies, regions, and local communities, we are now setting up a common roadmap till 2020. Our vision is zero bureaucracy, and we are now striving for digital where it's possible and personal where it's needed. And we will now give you some example of innovative digital solution. And first up will be the Swedish Digital Post, presented by Magnus.
Thank you, Christina. Can you hear me? Let me find this. Yes. As Christina told you all, we're now running a four-year implementation program based on the strategy we took a couple of years ago. And I will tell you about one of those infrastructural components called My Messages. I know that most of you guys run some kind of e-box or national secure mail system, and this is the Swedish way of doing it. Why do we all care about secure mail? It's actually, not many people think about this, the classical way citizens interact with the state. See, if you go to the court, you have the right to appear in person. But if you interact with the state, you've always interacted in writing. So this is actually the way we do things with the state, sending words back and forth. And this presentation is about a classical part of the state interface with the citizens, but it's mostly about how we try to build innovation into the national digital infrastructure. Because what we find when we build digital government is one thing is to build the first service. Keeping up with the pace of development is much more tricky. Because as Einstein put it, the best brains always work somewhere else. And that's particularly true for public sector, I think. Sorry. So our problem is, how can we tap into the potential for innovation that we find in IT industry? And this is one example. This is just the homepage of My Messages. I will run through the service and I will tell you how it works, right? It's quite simple. You go to the homepage, you sign up as for any account, and what you have to do is also download a mobile ID. And you have to then log into your internet bank to get together with a card and this in order to get hold of what you find in the upper corner there, which is the mobile ID solution. And what you find on the in the apps on the on your screen there, you see three different inboxes. The one to the left is the public, we call it the gray inbox. And then you have two commercial suppliers of basically the same service. These are two competing companies then selling the service of secure mail to the citizens. I will just quickly run through how it works. You basically log in, and this is the first mailbox. You log in, you can either do it by code, or if you have an ordinary iPhone, you use the fingerprint, right? Then you can see that you have a new message, but you can't access that message. You've also received an SMS notification or a mail in your ordinary mailbox, but you can't open that until you log in with your mobile ID. So it's secured by EID, right? When you log in, you switch over to the mobile bank ID app, you press your code, and you can open your mail. And in that mail, it's just one-way communication, but if the agency wants to send you a link for further interaction, it can do that. So this is one of the commercial suppliers. You can also choose the other. The first one is called Digimail. The second is Kivra. And you can also use what we call the gray inbox. The difference between these are that in the gray inbox, you can only accept mail from public agencies. You can't mix private and public mail in that, but you can do that in the two private boxes. That provides an incentive for users to move to the private inboxes. This is not very innovative, you might think, and that's true. I think what's innovative here is the infrastructure in that lies behind it. My messages is actually two parts. It's one infrastructural part and that gray inbox you saw there. And the red box there is basically the infrastructure. And what happens is that an agency or municipality wants to send a mail to the citizen. It then goes through a control search where you have an address register where the register sees whether you want to have your mail in paper or digital. If you signed up, it goes digital to your inbox. If you've chosen paper, it still goes paper. So you still have the choice if you want to go paper. We haven't done a Denmark in that sense. And we're discussing whether we want to do a Denmark or not. And it's something we should discuss, the pros and cons of this. If you're digital, you go into your chosen digital inbox. And the heart of that concept is actually four parts of the infrastructure. You have a governance mechanism where you govern the private suppliers of secure mailboxes. You have a register for addresses, and you have a set of rules how this regime should work, and you have a control mechanism, right? And then persons and businesses can then get easy access to any mail from the public sector whenever you need it. And so you actually have a three-part trip for a mail. You have an agency wanting to send a mail. You have often a mediator, which is a print shop. In that mediator, you have the address register saying whether I signed up to go digital or I still want to stay analog. And then that print shop takes the message to your chosen inbox. Now, there are certain advantages with this, and this is the reason why I want to talk to you today. This infrastructure allows for continuous competition between market players, which will drive innovation. It won't be the case that we procured one solution and that's it, and we will stick to that. We hope to build a market where we continuously keep our IT industry on its toes to bring innovation to this market. And it creates also a demand for true user-centered design, because if you have a market, you want to make sure that the customers are happy with your service. Now, of course, if we would just create our own public inbox, we would have problems of getting users to use it, right? So here we're using the marketing of the private actors to keep pushing users to go digital. And then if once they've chosen to go digital with private actors, they will automatically get digital post from the public sector as well. And it introduces a choice for users, what kind of user interface you want to have. You want to have the key interface or you want to have the digital interface, and we hope to see more market players that could then gear the user experience to a set of your set of needs. But would it be fun if this would all be easy? No, of course we have some challenges trying to work this market. It's a fairly hefty investment in building that first infrastructure, but once you have that in place, it's quite, we think, cheap to operate because we rely on the services of the private actors. It's also challenging to find a sustainable business model for private actors to sustain free access by public sector because the EID carries a cost. So here we have an interrelationship with the EID regime, and finding a sustainable business model with the My Messages and the EID is challenging. And of course, you lose control over the interface, how you meet the citizen, but that's the point of innovation. You need to let go of control of the interface to let the market players continuously innovate. And this is, as Christina said, a very important part of the program. We want to work actively with market players to keep up the innovation speed in the e-government sector. This is the reason why we're setting up a private institute for digital government. It will be a player that will procure pre-commercial research and development of innovative and collaborative e-government services. It will be a set of partners, founding partners, that take resources to the institute, and associated partners that participate per project. And the institute will then, per project, get an I-team to produce within a short period of time, 3 to 6 months, to have a prototype up and running. There will be no studies, there will be no long-term discussions. It will go to produce that prototype in order to get that into a test bed. The first program that we're running is the life event, building a house. How can we make that easier? How can we digitize the whole process of building a house? And that is combined with a bigger assignment to a set of agencies that will work with the institute to merge the what the public sector needs to do in terms of infrastructure development and then more fast-paced development of digital services. We can initiate research, long-term research program, and we will run accelerator programs because we think that the startup scene in Stockholm, to some extent, would be very, we would like to foster that startup scene to have people going into the business of building innovative social digital solutions. And we think there's a market out there. As I told you, we have some challenges when it comes to building a market for innovative public services. And in that sense, it's interesting to be here because our experience is that, yes, we do believe this is the way to go, but Sweden is actually a bit small. So wouldn't it be nice if we could build a Nordic-Baltic market for innovative public services? I think that would be an interesting part of the digital single market to spur innovation, but that means we have to sit down and maybe agree on a common standard for e-boxes. And then set common rules to have our players compete with each other. How can we do that? We will invite all of you Nordic guys here, Nordic CIOs, to the ICA meeting on the 7th to 9th September to the Institute to sit down and start that discussion. Because we believe we need to move that. And I think it's really interesting that the DSM package is coming out now, because I think it's a really good initiative within that, and it would place, together with the EID, two extremely important infrastructural components for the service directive in place, if we could agree on that. And so this is an open invitation. You will get the invitation a bit later. And now, and this will take place in the new Nod building in Kista, which is one of the fifth, I think, 1 to 5 hottest IT hubs in the world, on the eGov lab, what we call the Swedish Social Accelerator. And this is a way we want to work. We want to bring in IT industry to work on e-government solutions. And our next speaker is a brilliant example of that. This is Klaus. We'll talk about Mobilearn. And Mobilearn was the winner of the best social innovation in Europe, I think, 2013, and won the gold mobile in 2014, I think. So you've done a really good job about showing us how entrepreneurs can work with the government services. Klaus.
Hello, everyone. We got the IT breakdown. No, not. Okay, hello, everyone. I'm Klaus. I'm working within the private sector, so my presentation will be faster. Okay, so this is the content of the presentation. Why? Why does we even exist? It's a huge question, but I'm actually thinking about Mobilearn, nothing else. And I will talk a little bit about why we have this service. I will also address how we work with integration of newcomers and immigrants. And I will also share with you our business model. First of all, a glance at the world. I especially thank our peer agency for cutting off 15 kilos of my body fat by cutting the picture like this. That's nice. This is actually why we were receiving European Investment Bank's grand prize for best socioeconomic innovation in December 2012. And we were very honored to get that prize, as Magnus mentioned. So, first of all, there's a lot of people moving around in the world. And it's due to war, it's due to economical crisis. And there's a lot of people moving around. And in Sweden, we have more than 200,000 immigrants coming each year, as it looks right now. And when I started to look at this, I actually got the idea from the invention fairly early. I was a workforce immigrant myself in 1996, moving to the States. Coming there, I realized that even though I have a job, I do speak English, to some extent at least, and I got money. It took some time to get integrated, to understand how the society worked. And for instance, one thing, who will give you the social security number? Is it INS or is it IRS? And I realized that fairly early that for a country like the US, entirely built on immigrants, there was no single place for me as an immigrant to actually find all the information on how to get integrated into the society. And that kind of ticked me off. And I moved back after September 11, back to Sweden again. I started to work within the mobile industry 2006, which was 1 year before iPhone arrived. And I was one of those fools standing on stage like this, claiming that 2007 is the year of the mobile, and 2008 is the year of the mobile, and 2009, and it went on for quite a while. And in 2010, I was listening to a radio show regarding how we were actually integrating foreigners into the Swedish society. And I thought, why doesn't anyone create a service to help them? And one of the reasons for waiting until 2012 to actually start this program was that, well, everyone didn't use a cell phone, even though I did, in that kind of way, surfing the internet and so on. And today, there are more than 6 billion subscribers to telephone services. If you need to compare that with something, I can tell you there's about 2 billion toilet chairs in the world. And well, we're there right now. Everyone is using a cell phone. I mean, 81% of the banking in Africa is done through M-Pesa, which is an entirely mobile service. So, what if there was a service? It is a great challenge to be a newcomer. In Sweden, we actually give all the newcomers 60 hours of classroom education. So try to imagine how to learn everything about Estonia in 60 hours. What agency is doing what? What kind of obligations do you have in the country? It's kind of tricky, isn't it? Imagine that. And based on that, I decided to turn it around a little bit and provide one single service in your cell phone that gives you all the governmental and societal information exactly when you need it, where you need it. Because if you look at the authorities and the government, they have a plan to give all the citizens all the information in every channel. But as I started this presentation, if I don't know where to look for it, if I don't know if it's INS or IRS that's going to give me the social security number, how would I know? So I decided to create this one-stop shopping for immigrants, where they could actually receive the information in their own way. So I started to ask the users instead of asking the government. Sounds easy, doesn't it? So we call this a fast track to integration. It's personal, it's here when you need it. It has great relevance since what we do is basically pulling the open information, all the open data, from the government agencies. We put it together in one place. So it's kind of a mini Google, but with quality information. That's what we do. And of course, we got reliable sources with Fink if the government provides us relevant information. So, one thing that I realized fairly early was that, okay, I've been Googling things or searching the web for some years. I mean, I've been into the IT industry for, like mentioned before, 24 years, and I know how to find things on the internet. But imagine that you have a little bit different cultural background, or you only been to school for 2 years. Maybe your spelling is inaccurate. And all we do today within searches is actually word matching. So for instance, if I need to find a word or find information about ambulance, how to get an ambulance, I know the word ambulance. Of course, I could search for it and I can spell it as well. But if you have a short educational background and you have another cultural background, the first word that might pop up might be sick transport, right? And imagine then, if I'm not aware that sick transport is spelled with a C in the middle, so it's sick transport. Try to find any information in any governmental database regarding ambulance then. It's impossible, isn't it? So what we did was that we created our own search engine for a start. So you can misspell. We will do a phonetic search. We will actually spell it right. And then we will, based on the information in the article, we will provide you a result, which might be hospital, fast transportation, trauma, and stuff like that, and we would come up with a mathematical algorithm that would provide, okay, this is the article of ambulance, this misspelled sick transport. And of course, we'd patent it. But not only that, if you came to Sweden from Somalia like 2 months ago, how on earth would you know if you got a pain somewhere, you have to go to 1177.se to find the information? It's a bit tricky to figure out, right? Especially if you don't speak Swedish. So what we've done is that we translated all the governmental information, or more correctly, we retranslated the governmental information, because to be frank, the translations made by Swedish government and governmental agencies sucks, okay? So we had to redo everything. So what we do is that we actually presenting the search results in the native tongue of the newcomers and in Swedish. So you can actually learn Swedish as well. Simple, isn't it? Today we support only 5 languages. We are planning to add 2 more, but those are the 5 largest languages that's actually spoken in Sweden. And we spend shitloads of money in translation, because what we do is a contextual translation. You can't just pull a word like etableringsbidrag in Swedish and try to marry 2 words into one because you make it cheaper. we actually do a contextual thing, so we explain the word instead, which is really good for someone that just arrived to a new culture. And we include more than 15 governmental agencies into this. So what we created is our own platform, a content management platform. And standing here as a private contractor, I can tell you that I've got the largest governmental database in Sweden, translated into several languages. And we have a content management platform that we build ourselves as well. And this is pretty interesting, because if you look at verksamt.se, this is a website that helps people in Sweden to start their own companies. And if you look at Somalian people, they really like to start their own company. If you offer them a job, they would probably say no, because they want to form and start their own company and run their own business. Unfortunately, verksamt.se isn't translated into Somali. We have a problem here, right? But we translated it, so it's all right. They can start companies in Sweden nowadays. No problems. But this is basically what we're doing. We also provide local information from the municipalities in the same platform. So it's actually one-stop shopping for all kind of information from the public sector. And are we doing any business on this? When I sent this presentation about a week ago, we had 74 municipalities in Sweden buying this from us, providing to all the newcomers in their municipality. But it was a week ago, so now it's 78. And we charge 60 euros for a 24-month license. And that's how it works. I told you my presentation was going to be a little bit faster, and it is. Thank you.
We don't let you go yet. Rather, I would have Christina and Magnus actually come on the stage as well, and let's have a bit of discussion and questions. I'll stand this way. Before we start with questions, actually, I'm not seeing any questions on Twitter. Guys, tweet. But actually, to motivate you to also ask here, what I can say is that whoever asks the best question from the live audience here gets a prize. So get ready with your questions, all right? But before I'll ask the first one to give you time to think a bit, it's fascinating, let's say, how exactly, let's say, you now have a new movement going on, exactly, a new government, everything, and some of the momentum is there. But I guess the hard trick is always with the people. And so the question I think I'll ask, starting from you, is with the digital post and box, are you hoping for the people to really get on board and really start using it?
Yes, we hope that. We've seen a tremendous increase on e-government usage. We hit 70% on the tax declaration this year, which is best so far in Sweden. And I think we're Swedes are digitally savvy, they're digitally mature. We still have a way to go for e-boxes, but I think if we don't do a Denmark, our best bet is to use the market commercialization and the market initiative they have to get usage going on that service.
All right. But a question to you. I think, funnily enough, let's say, although you started from Sweden, as you see from all the news, there might be quite a market opening up in the whole of Europe now with the immigration waves coming. What about the expansion plans?
Well, I'm moving to London in November to start up the UK branch. After that, we will open up Canada, which isn't Europe, but far enough. Well, and after that, we're looking to Germany and the US.
Okay.
Yeah.
But exactly, like as the news say, I mean, that might be even more sort of push for you to go even faster, right?
That's right.
All right. But you guys now had time to think. So, can I get a question from the audience? Can I have a mic here, perhaps? There's a mic coming from the back. Just a second, Jon. So you will now be given a hard time by somebody from Iceland.
No, a soft time. The question is, this is running now. What has been the reception of the immigrants? That is very important. You have a very nice system here, but how it has been received? I mean, you have deals now with the municipalities, but at the end, it is the reaction of the end user, which is the important. Could you elaborate a bit on that?
Yeah. Well, first of all, there's coming a lot of immigrants right now. And if you look at the Swedish migration, they wouldn't actually start an errand until 10 to 12 months after the immigrants came to the country seeking for asylum. And imagine that. There are not a single dime spent on those guys until they actually have an open errand. So they're not learning Swedish. They don't learn anything about the Swedish society. They're living in barracks, basically, in Sweden for 10 to 12 months without learning anything about the Swedish society. Do you think they feel welcome? Not really. With our solution, that's really cheap, they will feel welcome from the beginning and they can start their road to integration immediately when the drive is at highest. So it's been a really warm welcome for our service.
And I guess there was one question also came from the Twitter feed that do all the immigrants have the smartphones? So technologically, there's no obstacles there, or?
Well, you don't need to have a smartphone to use our service. It works on any internet-connected phone from 2006 and onwards. But to give you the right answer on that one, 95% has smartphones nowadays. Yes.
Good. Yes, please, a mic there. Is there a microphone in the back? Sorry, we'll get more mics by the break.
I have a question to Mobilearn. I'm from a translation company, and we translate various platforms for public and private sector. The information is changing in real time. How much do you translate, actually, of the information that is actually displayed by the public sector offices? Well, how do you manage the translation flow?
Well, basically what we do is that we have a civilians of all the governmental databases and sites that we use. And every week we send new batches for translation, which is really expensive. And the information is, about 60% of the information is changed year on year. But we do that accordingly. So it's always updated.
You actually translate also the changing information, not only the...
Yeah, the changing information, that's right.
So you would really like some linked data, I guess.
Yeah.
Yes, and the last question from Gaitis. Can you pass the mic? Here, yeah.
Hello, thank you, Gaitis. The question from Mark Senzel regarding this e-box. The one thing is that you connect the private sector is a good way how to this innovation could grow. The question is how you manage this data privacy questions about putting those government papers through a private company to the citizens. Is there some certification or how you manage those questions? Thank you.
Yes, it's part of that infrastructure. I told you about these four parts of the infrastructure. One set of the rules is the requirements you put on the private suppliers when it comes to personal integrity, security, and all of those factors you need to have to enable and to allow them to use the infrastructure. And that's the Swedish tax agency that is responsible for setting the appropriate set of rules to ensure a compliance with integration legislation or security criteria, whatever. So that's an integral part of the infrastructure, that set of rules.
So we lost the very last question to Christina. You talked about exactly sort of very nice slogan there that you would like the government to be digital when possible, personal, always is needed, right? But can you imagine that there at some point will be a time for cost reasons or whatever reasons where we actually have to push everybody to go digital, at least with some services? Sort of like, I guess, what Denmark has been trying to do for quite some time. So might the slogan be changing at some point?
Yeah, it might be, but we are testing it. I think our point of view is that even if it's personal, it could be digital as well. So, and even a digital service could be you could be giving the customers better service on a personal basis if it's digital or if it's instead of it's paper based. So it doesn't exclude each other.
So you would still prefer yourself to have a right to text, right?
Yeah, just joking. I love text messages. Yes.
All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, let's thank the Swedes.